चैवानरोत्तमम्
वरं चैवानरोत्तमम्
देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेषु भवद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवति उत्तमा श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिके. So we're reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 2, Chapter 5, entitled The Cause of All Causes, text number 15. Narayana Paraveda,
Narayana Paraveda,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paramaka,
Narayana Paramaka,
Narayana Paraveda,
Narayana Paraveda,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paramaka,
Narayana Paramaka,
Narayana Paraveda,
Narayana Paraveda,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Deva Narayanangaja,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paraloka,
Narayana Paramaka. Translation. The Vedic literatures are made by and are meant for the Supreme Lord. The demigods are also meant for serving the Lord or for serving the Lord as parts of his body. The different planets are also meant for the sake of the Lord, and different sacrifices are performed just to please him. You can all repeat. The Vedic literature,
the Vedic literature
are made by and are meant for,
are made by and are meant for
the Supreme Lord.
The Supreme Lord.
The demigods are also meant,
the demigods are also meant
for serving the Lord,
for serving the Lord
as parts of his body.
As parts of his body.
The different planets,
the different planets
are also meant,
are also meant
for the sake of the Lord,
for the sake of the Lord,
and different sacrifices,
and different sacrifices
are performed,
performed
just to please him.
Just to please him.
Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. According to the Vedanta Sutras, Shastra Yonitvat, the Supreme Lord is the author of all revealed scriptures, and all revealed scriptures are for knowing the Supreme Lord. Veda means knowledge that leads to the Lord. The Vedas are made just to revive the forgotten consciousness of the conditioned souls. And any literature not meant for reviving God consciousness is rejected at once by the Narayana Parat devotees. Such deluding books of knowledge, not having Narayana as their aim, are not at all knowledge, but are the playgrounds for crows who are interested in the rejected refuse of the world. Any book of knowledge, science, or art must lead to the knowledge of Narayana. Otherwise, it must be rejected. That is a way of advancement of knowledge. The supreme worshipful deity is Narayana. The demigods are recommended secondarily for worship in relation to Narayana, because the demigods are assisting hands in the management of the universal affairs. As the officers of a kingdom are respected due to their relation to the king, the demigods are worshipped due to their relation to the Lord. Without the Lord's relation, worship of the demigods is unauthorized, avide purvakam, just as it is improper to water the leaves and branches of a tree without watering its root. Therefore, the demigods are also dependent on Narayan. The lokas, or different planets, are attractive because they have different varieties of life and bliss, partially representing the Satchidananda Vigraha. Everyone wants the eternal life of bliss and knowledge. In the material world, such an eternal life of bliss and knowledge is progressively realized in the upper planets. But after reaching there, one is inclined to achieve further progress along the path back to Godhead. Duration of life with a proportionate quantity of bliss and knowledge may be increased from one planet to another. One can increase the duration of life to thousands and hundreds of thousands of years in different planets, but nowhere is there eternal life. But one who can reach the highest planet, that of Brahma, can aspire to reach the planets in the spiritual world where life is eternal. Therefore, the progressive journey from one planet to another culminates in reaching the supreme planet of the Lord, Mat Dham, where life is eternal and full of bliss and knowledge. All different kinds of sacrifices are performed just to satisfy Lord Narayan with a view to reach him. And the best sacrifice recommended in this age of Kali is Sankirtan Yajna, the mainstay of the devotional service of a Narayana Para devotee. Om Magyana Timirandasya Jananjana Shalakaya Chaksurumilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Vanchakaupatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhubhayevaca Paditanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 verses from 2nd Canto Srimad Bhagavatam. In the 2nd Canto we have different personalities speaking. It begins with Sukadeva Goswami, who just appears at the end of the 1st Canto, and he's instructing Maharaj Parikshit. And then we have Lord Brahma speaking to Narada Muni. Narada Muni is one of the sons of Brahma. And Narada was thinking that Brahma was the Supreme Lord, and Brahma has to tell his son that he's not supreme. Then later on at the end, the last few chapters of the second canto, we have Lord Vishnu speaking to Brahma, and you get the speaking of the Chatushloki Bhagavatam, the original Bhagavatam, which is only 4 verses. So that comes later in chapter 9 and 10, there in the second canto. Okay, so here we have an interesting verse. Lord Brahma is describing the position of Lord Narayan. He said, the Vedic literatures are made by and meant for the Supreme Lord. Vedic literature. What is Vedic literature? It can mean different things. There is Shruti and there is Smriti. Some people only accept Shruti. Shruti means the 4 Vedas, Rig, Samar, Yajur, Atharva. That is Shruti. There are some scholars, philosophers, that will only accept the Shruti. Ishopanishad is one of the is part of Shruti. So Ishopanishad is important. Some scholars, they won't accept Bhagavad Gita. Although Bhagavad Gita is Gita-Upanishad, but Bhagavad Gita is from Mahabharata, and Mahabharata is Smriti, it's not Shruti. Actually, the Smriti is more important than the Shruti. But there are some people, they won't accept Shmi. So Vedas, Vedic literatures, are meant for understanding Narayana. If you, if any other book, any book which doesn't help us to understand the Supreme Lord, then it is useless. Now devotional service has to be performed according to Shastras. An important verse is given to us by Rupa Goswami. He says, Shruti Smriti Puranadi Pancharatriki Vidim Vinam Aikantiki Harer Bhattir Utpatayaiva Kaupati. That if devotional service is not performed according to the Shruti, or the Smriti, or the Itihasas, or the Puranas, then it is simply a disturbance to society. So the idea of Vedic literature, according to the Vaishnavas, is all standard Shastras, the Shruti, the Smriti, the Puranas, and the Itihasas. We accept all of them as scriptures. Prabhupada quotes from many different Puranas, many different scriptures. Not only the Shruti, not only the original Vedas, but the Smriti also. And devotional service should be performed according to these scriptures. But the purpose of all these scriptures is to understand Narayana. If one is simply using the scriptures to speak about the path of impersonal Brahman, path to impersonal Brahman realization or Sayuja Mukti, or if one is just simply thinking about material benefit, going to higher planets, drinking the somaras, or economic development and sense gratification, then that kind of religion, that is not good. That is not really what is being described here. The whole purpose of all of these Vedic literatures is to understand Narayana, to understand the Supreme Lord. And if reading the scriptures, we're not able to understand, to come to understand the Supreme Lord, then it's simply a waste of time. It's simply wasted. So the Vedas are mentioned, and then mentions that the demigods are also meant to for the purpose of understanding the Supreme Lord Narayana. The demigods are described to be different parts of the body of the Lord. Just like the example is, the sun is like the eye of the Lord, and the different planetary systems, they also represent the body of the Lord, like the lower planets are like the feet of the Lord, and then the earthly planets are like the waist of the Lord, and the higher planets are the head of the Lord. In this way, all the different features of the material world, all the 33 crore devas and all the infinite number of planets which are within the universe, they can all be understood in relation to the Supreme Lord, Narayana. There is no purpose in worshipping gods if we're not recognizing the Supreme Lord, Narayana. Now we can also worship the demigods, we can also worship the devas, if we're worshipping the Deva as being part of, as being subordinate to the Supreme Lord. Yeah. We can offer worship to them. Actually, one devotee wrote to Prabhupada, and he asked Prabhupada if he could worship Ganesh, because he'd heard that Lord Ganesh is Vigna Vinash, that he can destroy obstacles and the path. So this devotee was doing a lot of preaching. He was, you know, helping to raise funds for Prabhupada. At that time, we were building the temple in Juhu, in Mumbai. There's a nice temple in Juhu. So Prabhupada needed money. At that time, there was no money in India. Not like today. You know, At that time it was very difficult to raise funds in India. And especially for Hare Krishna movement, we were a new movement. We didn't have many people helping us. We were all foreigners there in India. And the Indian people were only just, they were just watching and looking. They were not joining Hare Krishna movement at that time. So Prabhupada didn't have any money. He began the movement, he went to America with no money, and he began the movement with no money, and he came back to India, and he didn't bring any money. But, you know, somehow he was able to get this land that Juhu wanted to build the temple. So the devotees were going preaching, and how were they preaching? They were doing book distribution. Book distribution, very important part of our preaching program. Hare Krishna movement is famous for book distribution. Prabhupada wrote books and he liked us to distribute the books. Very important, if we want to distribute Krishna consciousness, the best way to give people Krishna consciousness is give them a book and get them to buy the book. That's even better. If they give the money for the book, then it's even better. Sometimes, of course, nowadays they're giving books away free, but, you know, in Prabhupada's time, usually we were selling the books. Because when they give away the books free, it means somebody has donated the money for them, to pay for them. But in Prabhupada's time, nobody was doing that. We were just selling the books. So one devotee, one sannyasi, young sannyasi, he had gone to Japan and he had taken a group of young men, young brahmacharis with him, and he'd taken them there to Japan, and they were collecting money for Prabhupada to build the temple at Juhu. So that's how we have that nice temple at Juhu. The devotees there were in Japan and they were selling books and raising funds, and the money was going to Prabhupada. So the devotee who was in charge of these boys, it was not easy for them, it was very difficult. Every day going out selling books, and Japan people are very busy. You know, they don't like to stop and talk to you. Anybody goes to Japan, you can see how they walk there. All walking very fast, all rushing everywhere. Nobody stops, nobody talks. You're not like Bahrain, you know. Of course, nobody walks here. Everybody drives everywhere. Eh? So, anyway, in Tokyo, these places, the boys, the young devotees were there preaching, distributing the books, and there were many obstacles. So this one devotee got the idea, said, I should worship Ganesh. And he wrote to Prabhupada, and he asked Prabhupada if he could worship Ganesh to help him to destroy the obstacles. He said, and so Prabhupada wrote back to him, he said, if you want to worship Ganesh, he said, you have to give me $10,000 every month. I think it was like that, $10,000, or maybe it was $100,000 a month, I can't remember. Anyway, like that, Prabhupada asked a very big amount. He said, otherwise you cannot do it. So Prabhupada did not encourage the devotees, said we need to worship demigods. But sometimes we do see some devotees, they're worshipping. It's mentioned in Srimad Bhagavatam. There's one person mentioned, Prithu Maharaj, I think, was doing some yajna, and at that time he was worshipping demigods. But he was worshipping them as limbs of the Supreme Lord. He did not worship them as being the Supreme. That is the point, that if we want to worship the devas, you can do it, but you have to recognize that they're not the Supreme Lord, that the Supreme Lord is Narayan, and the demigods, the other gods, these devas, they are all limbs, they're like parts of the body of Lord Narayan. Just like I said, Surya is like the sun god, you see? And then all these different demigods, you can read in Srimad Bhagavatam, it's described how different demigods, they represent different parts, different aspects of the body of the Supreme Lord Narayana. So that kind of worship is good. Otherwise it's avidhi purvakam. Prabhupada is quoting from Bhagavad Gita. that whatever a man worships to other, offers to other God, is actually meant for me alone, but is offered without true and without proper understanding. But without proper understanding is avidhi purvakam. It's not offered with proper understanding. They're offering to some demigod and they're thinking this demigod is supreme. It is like trying to bribe someone. Instead of going to the chief man, you find some lesser officer and you bribe, you offer him a bribe rather than go to the head man. So this is what demigod worship is. It's described in Bhagavad Gita by Lord Krishna. Antavattu falam tejam tadbhavati alpamedasham. That whatever results you get from the worship of the demigods will be limited and temporary. And this kind of worship is, Krishna uses the word alpa medasaha. He said this is done by people with small brains. Alpa means very meager, very small. They're not very intelligent people. So Krishna also says that those whose minds are distorted by material desires will worship the demigods. And the result is they get, the fruit of their worship is limited and temporary. So this is why they're not very intelligent people. But often people don't know. They didn't know, they just do what everybody, they said, well, my mother and father, they did this, or my grandfather did this, you were just following. And we don't really know. Where did we get all this from? This is the wrong understanding. We're thinking we just worship that God, but we have to understand the purpose of worshiping all these gods is actually meant to please Lord Narayan. That above all of these different gods, there is one Supreme Lord. We say Ekala Ishwara Krishna or Sabrijya. There is one supreme controller. All others are the servants. And a good verse also, which comes from the Shruti, from the Vedas, a Vedic verse is Nityo Nityanam Chaitanas Chaitananam Eko Bhavanam Yovedati Kama. That amongst all eternals, there is one supreme eternal person. Amongst all conscious beings, there is one supremely conscious person. That one Supreme Lord is providing the needs of everyone. So these are important verses from the scriptures, and they are describing to us that there is one Supreme Lord. We are called monotheists. Theism means science of God. So we believe in one God. Sometimes people think, oh, this religion, we believe in many gods. But actually, one God. Just like on the wall, there's Dasa Avatar. So people may think, oh, many gods. They think, oh, you believe also in many gods. No, we believe in one God. There's one God, but he has many different forms. He takes many different colors, and he appears at different times for different purposes. Now, just like when the earth falls into the bottom of the sea, he comes as the Lord Varaha in the form of a boar to pick up the earth from the bottom of the sea. And when he wants to churn the milk ocean, at that time then he takes the form of Kurma and he's able to hold up the Mandalachara mountain. And when he has to defeat all the different benedictions which were given to Hiranyakashipu by Lord Brahma, at that time the Lord comes as half man, half lion, as Lord Narsimhadev. And when he comes to get the charity from Bali Maharaj, then he comes as a Vamana. He comes as a dwarf Brahmana. So for different purposes, different occasions, he will take different forms and appear in different positions in society. But we should understand God is one. That means there is one God, one supreme God. And it's not that we are all God. We are all His servants. We have an eternal relationship with Him. And the demigods are also His servants. But the demigods are superior servants. They have a bigger position. They're taking a greater responsibility. How did they get in that position? How did they come to that position? By their pious activities. One reaches heaven by doing a lot of pious activities. And there they may be given the responsibility to be the demigod, to be some demigod. But they are not the Supreme Lord. It's not that it is all one. There's a difference. There is one Supreme Lord, and there are many assisting demigods. And we are under the control of all of these different demigods. We should understand how the Spirit, how the Lord organizes everything. Just like in this country, in every country we go, there will be a government, and there will be somebody in charge of the government, and there will be ministers, somebody is in charge of the police department, somebody is in charge of the health department, somebody is in charge of the education department. So, and similarly, for the universe, for the whole universe, there are different ministers. They are all the different demigods, and they are given the responsibility to act on behalf of the Supreme Lord. Demigods are not pure devotees. They're devotees, but they're not pure devotees. Because they're attached to having some position, some designation in the material world. And that's why they get that position. More exalted than the demigods are the pure devotees. Because the pure devotees, their lips are always decorated with words this glorifying the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana. The devotees' lips are always speaking, chanting the glories of the Supreme Lord. The demigods are attached. They're attached to having a nice, comfortable position in the material world, at the same time, they're obedient to the orders of the Lord. So we have to understand the position of the demigods. And then finally, then it mentions also about sacrifices, that the purpose of all sacrifices is to please Lord Narayana. Different sacrifices are described in the fourth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. In the fourth chapter there, it mentions how we can sacrifice different material possessions. Somebody may like to sacrifice their wealth. We give some donation, maybe you put your donation in that box over here. It's a sacrifice. Somebody makes some sacrifice, sometimes maybe you don't give charity to the temple, maybe you give some other kind of charity. You send money home to your family members or something like that. So some kind of, there is sacrifice, some kind of sacrifice. There is sacrifice of land. Maybe you have a piece of land and you donate it to the temple so they can build a temple. Or you donate it for a school. You do some kind of charity like this, some kind of sacrifice. What is the purpose of sacrifice? The purpose of sacrifice is to develop transcendental knowledge. And that transcendental knowledge will then lead us to understand the Supreme Lord Narayana. So we have to understand how everything, the purpose of everything we do, is to understand more the position of the Lord, the Supreme Lord, described to be Narayana. So sacrifices, different sacrifices we said are mentioned. We can sacrifice possessions. We can also sacrifice knowledge. Just like we're studying Srimad Bhagavatam, that is also yajna, that is also sacrifice. Or then, of course, you also do kirtan yajna, sankirtan yajna. That is a real dharma, the real yajna for the Kali Yuga. Kali Yuga dharma, Hari Nam Sankirtan. Krishna Shakti Vininai Tara Pravartan. In the Kali Yuga, the Yuga Dharma is Sankirtan. So very nice, Bharin, you have many nice kirtaniers here. You have to have more and more kirtan. By kirtan, then we will develop more taste for the holy name, for our chanting. So kirtan is very important. Nowadays, around the world, more and more groups of devotees, especially the youth, are coming together and organizing kirtan mela. We just had one there in Malaysia, all the youth in Malaysia, they brought Govinda Maharaj there and some other different kirtaniers, and then they had their own kirtaniers. And for the whole Saturday and Sunday, they had kirtan non-stop. So this way they were all relishing the holy name. Of course, in Mayapur, at Gaur Purnima time, they have kirtan mela there for 7 days. From morning till night, kirtan going on. The people, they go in there in the morning, they don't come out the whole day. They don't eat nothing, they forget everything. They just go in there and they just absorb themselves in the holy name. Chanting and chanting and chanting. And they come out there, sometimes they'll come out, you know, sometimes it will be very, very late when they come out. And of course on Ekadasi, the devotees in Mayapur, they will have a group of devotees that stay up all night and they will do kirtan in the temple room, the whole night for the Ekadasi Vrat. This is yajna, this is sacrifice in the chanting of the holy name. We can do also japa yajna. That is also a good yajna, mentioned in Bhagavad Gita. Huh? That of sacrifices, I am chanting of the holy name. So you can do that japa, you can do kirtan, or you can do japa. When we take initiation, we make a vow to do japa, to chant at least 16 rounds on our beads. We don't make a vow that I'll do kirtan or that I'll attend to do the Hare Sankirtan or anything, but the vow is chant the holy name on our beads, japa. That is important. That is our own personal meditation on the holy name of Krishna. Both are important though. If we don't have the taste to chant on our beads, we get the taste by kirtan. The more there is nice kirtan, then it attracts people to chant the holy name. Srila Prabhupada sent devotees to England to begin Krishna consciousness in Europe. He sent 3 householder couples to England, and they were expert in kirtan. They were very nice chanters of the holy name. In fact, that was how, when they met George Harrison, the famous musician in England, he liked them so much, he told, we must make a record. And he helped them to make a record, and then the music was popular all over the world. All over the world people were hearing Hare Krishna mantra. And it was became very famous because of this record. So these devotees were musically, they were talented musicians. And they were able to chant the holy name nicely for the pleasure of George Harrison, and then ultimately became for the pleasure of the world. But actually there's no material qualification to chant the holy name. For preaching, it's nice if you have good kirtaniers, then it can attract people. But on a spiritual sense, it doesn't require any particular qualification. Any sincere person can call the holy name of the Lord. It is not the melodious sound of the holy name, But it is a pure chanting with love and devotion which brings us to know the Lord. So we have to understand how Lord Narayan is the cause of all causes, the origin of all everything. Everything is meant for Him, for His pleasure, everything that we do. Just like in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna describes, Yat karoshi yajashnasi yajjahosi dadasi yat yat tapasyasta kuntiya tat kurushva mad arpanam. This is karma yoga. Krishna is describing karma yoga. All that you do, all that you eat, all that you offer and give away, do it as an offering for me. Arpanam, karma arpanam, make an offering for me. Now, Lord Chaitanya did not accept karma arpanam as the highest thing. When he was discussing with Ramananda Rai, Lord Chaitanya asked Ramananda Rai, give me some verse about the goal of life from the scriptures. So Lord Chaitanya began by speaking about Varnashram. Oh, we should follow Varnashram. Varnashram acharampara purushena parapunam vishnamarajate pumam. Like that, the goal of life is to follow Varnashram, and that is satisfying to Lord Vishnu. But Lord Chaitanya said, this is external. Give me something else. Just simply following Varnashram. Somebody may be, oh, a very good brahmachari, or a very good sannyasi, but are they devotees? Maybe not. You don't know. You don't know what they're doing in their mind, what they're thinking, what is their purpose. They're just following Varnashram. That is piety, some pious activity you get. That's material. It's not spiritual. So Lord Chaitanya said, give higher, go higher. So then Ramananda Rai suggested karma arpanam, offering. I quoted the verse, all that you do, all that you eat, all that you offer and give away, do it for me. But Lord Chaitanya said, no, this is not very good. Why not? Because we'll think, oh, okay, we'll give it to Vishnu, we'll give it to Shiva, we'll give it to Kali, we'll give it to Krishna, to the goat, we'll give it to the pig. They don't make any distinction. They think all is the same, all is one. Lord Chaitanya didn't want that. He doesn't want people thinking it's all one. It doesn't matter who you worship, all the gods are the same. This is not the case. This is not true. So Lord Chaitanya rejected karma arpanam. Karma arpanam is different from bhakti yoga, right? Bhakti yoga. What's the difference? In karma arpanam, we do the work, then we surrender something from the result. We give something from what we've done. But bhakti yoga is first surrender and then work for Krishna. The surrender comes first, and bhakti yoga will do anything for Krishna. But in karma yoga, we're attached to work. We're attached to working in a particular way. Oh, I will cook for Krishna. Oh, don't ask me to be the pujari. No, I'm not going to do aarti. Don't ask me to clean. I'm not going to clean. I will only cook. You know, we have our reservations. This is the karma yoga mood. I will do that. I can give the class. I can do the kirtan. I'm not going to do anything else. This is karma yoga, where you've got reservations, what we want to do. I like this, I don't want to do that. That's not real bhakti yoga. Bhakti yoga is we'll do whatever Krishna wants us to do. Bhakti yoga is first surrender and then work for Krishna. We'll do anything Krishna wants for us. So Lord Chaitanya had good reasons why he rejected karma arpanam. Because Lord Chaitanya has come to preach bhakti yoga. What is bhakti yoga? So you may think, sarva dharmam parigyajna mamikam sharanam braja, surrender to Krishna. Huh? Is this bhakti yoga? Lord Chaitanya said, no. Why? Because one may surrender, but he has his motives. He's surrendering to Krishna, but he's got some material motives why he's surrendering. We had one man in Hong Kong, came to Prabhupada. He said, Swamiji, I want to take sannyas. Prabhupada said, oh, very good, you want to take sannyas? Why? The man said, oh, my wife and three kids, I have to get away from them, it's hell. Let me take sannyas. So, of course, Prabhupada did not accept this foolish man. But this is about somebody, I want to be devotee. Why? I have a nice place to eat and sleep. That is not the good mood for surrender, is it? You know, we say, I know I'm surrendering to Krishna, I'll surrender everything. Just give me a nice place to eat and sleep. We say, oh yeah, okay, you can be here, but you have to go out and sell the books. You can't just simply eat and sleep. That is not Krishna consciousness, right? So that kind of surrender is no good. So Lord Chaitanya said, it's not enough. You have to go higher. Give some other verse. So then Ramananda Rai said, well, Brahma Bhuta Prasanatma Nasochati Nakanchati Sama Sarveshu Bhuteshu Mad Bhaktim Labhate Param. But Lord Chaitanya also said, this is also not really enough, because this is speaking more about the Brahman. We're seeing all living entities equally. Where is the devotion? It is just simply fixed on the Brahman. So then Ramananda Rai gave a verse which was taken from Srimad Bhagavatam, which was acceptable to Lord Chaitanya. And the verse was spoken by Lord Brahma. Jane prayasam udapasya namanta eva jivanti sam mukaritam bhavadiya bartam stane stita shruti gatam tanvan manobir ye prayaso jita jitopi asitai strilokyam. In this verse, Lord Brahma is making very many important points. He is saying that stani stita, you can stay in your position. You don't have to give up your position. We may be thinking, oh, I have to become a sannyasi, oh, I have to leave home, oh, I have to change my position. No, you can stay, remain in whatever position you're in. Because our position, whatever position we're in, it's not important. What is important is what you do in your position. And what we should be doing is we should be hearing about Krishna in the association of devotees. This is a real activity which will bring us to, which is pure devotional service. When you have the association of devotees and we're hearing topics of Krishna in their association, we're avoiding all sinful activities, then in this way, then we can conquer Krishna. Although Krishna is ajita, Krishna's unconquerable, but he becomes conquered by the pure love of his devotees. So when Lord Chaitanya heard this verse from the mouth of Ramananda Rai, then Lord Chaitanya said, yes, this is what I want to talk about. Now let us go into this verse. And then Lord Chaitanya began to explore more and more through the mouth of Ramananda Rai. He had Ramananda Rai reveal all the higher realms of devotional service through the different rasas, and then into Madhurya Ras and the different gopis, and then coming to the position of Srimati Radharani and her mood in serving the Supreme Lord Krishna. So this is Bhakti Yoga. Lord Chaitanya came to preach pure love of God, to give pure love of God to everyone. We have to understand how we can take up, how we can apply ourselves to the mission of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, to spread this Sankirtan movement. This is actually very much required. If all over the world, preachers are needed. But preachers are not just people who go out and give lectures, but everyone who is doing work for the Krishna consciousness movement is a preacher. Somebody is maintaining a center. That is preaching. somebody else is preparing the prasadam for the devotees, that is preaching. Somebody is worshipping the deities and dressing the deities, that is also preaching. Somebody is doing kirtan, that is also preaching. There are many different aspects to preaching. Somebody else may be having the website on the internet, and they're maintaining a website, that is also preaching. Of course, book distribution is also preaching. So there are many different aspects to preaching. Somebody, just like in Mayapur we have gardens, we have grounds, we have a lot of land there, we grow flowers. So growing the flowers is also preaching. And taking care of the cows is also preaching. Because people will come and they will see the cows. And we want them to see that the cows are being cared for and they're clean and they're healthy. And then if the cows are like that, then we can see that it's preaching. So preaching is many different facets. It is not just only simply sitting giving lecture, this preaching. But there are many things to be done for the service of Krishna. So we have to find out what can we do for the mission of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. How can we serve Lord Chaitanya? We can all do some service for Krishna. I was in Mayapur last year and I saw there was a few men from here. They're serving full time now in Mayapur. One man is working for the MIHE. Another man is working for the TOVP. There are so many different projects there, and Mayapur is a big community. There are so many different departments. One can find whatever work he would like to do. I think some man from, is it Bahrain or Dubai, he started up the Mayapur tourism. Where is he from? Huh? Dubai. Dubai, he's from Dubai. Oh, yeah. Okay, Mayapur tourism there, he's got the business going. No, there's so many things we can do for do it. The purpose is to help us to come closer to Krishna. That is the idea. Is this helping us to become more Krishna conscious, God conscious? If we're not moving closer, if we're not awakening our God consciousness, then it's not worth doing. Need to change the job. You need to do some other work. Find some other activity. Because everything, the purpose of everything is to help us to become more fixed in God consciousness. So every day, of course, you have to work, you have to keep a job, but every day we have also our spiritual duties. We have to chant, we have to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. This is our business as devotees. If we're not hearing and chanting, then simply working is not enough. It's not good. We had one devotee in Hyderabad. He was running the temple there in Hyderabad. They were building, the land had been donated. And one man gave land and we built the temple. But the one devotee who was in charge of managing it, he said, I'm so busy, I don't have time to chant my rounds. So when Prabhupada heard that, he said, then it is just a question of time before he will leave. If we are simply working, doing service, and not chanting Hare Krishna, then it is just a question of time before we will go away from Krishna consciousness. We have to keep up our chanting of the holy name. We have to do our sadhana. It is very important. It is essential. Otherwise, we will not be able to remain in Krishna consciousness. Because Maya, the material energy, is so powerful that it will drag us away. Just like if you're on a boat and you go to sea, you're on the boat, you have to be very careful the boat does not go far away, too far away from the shore. Because we may not feel the boat drifting with the tide. The tide moving and the boat can go all the way out, very far away from the shore. So like this we can get in big trouble. And so similarly in our activities, our spiritual life, If we're not regularly hearing and chanting, taking part in the worship, and having Krishna prasadam, then it's very difficult to keep our Krishna consciousness. If we're eating all the every day outside, all kinds of food cooked by non-devotees, maybe vegetarian, but still a lot of passion will be there because people are not devotees. We eat food, especially grains cooked by non-devotees. You have to take their karma. Prabhupada told us when devotees came to go to India for preaching, he said, don't take any grains cooked by non-devotees because the karma is in the grains. So, sinful people, they like to feed the devotees, give them their karma, get rid of all their karma, give them. So it requires some control, maybe a challenge for many of us. You have to go to work, you have to work, you have to eat, but you have to try to get food which is pure. You have to try to make some arrangement so that you don't have to eat food cooked by non-devotees. How to recognize a Vaishnava? That comes in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. One Lord Chaitanya was asked, how to recognize who is a devotee? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Krishna Bhakti, how does the verse, I forget the verse, I'm not remembering right now, but I remember the description that is, you have to associate with one who, you have to give up the asat sanga tyag evaishnav achar. Stri sanga ekasadu Krishna bhakti ar. Asat sanga tyag. Give up the association of the asat. Just like we're having satsang here. This is satsanga. We're associating with the eternal, with the spiritual knowledge, with the Supreme Lord. It is satsang. Sat means that which is eternal. The glories of the Lord, Srimad Bhagavatam. This is all eternal. So satsang, the chanting of the holy name, that is satsanga. But asat is the material. Television programs, movies, all this, and mundane cinemas. These kind of things, that is asat sangat tyag. You have to give up that up, that kind of association. One who is a devotee will not associate with the asat. Asat sangat tyag e Vaishnava achar. This is the achar, this is the behavior of the Vaishnava. Stri sanga eka sadhu Krishna bhakti ara. They will not associate with people who are, they will not associate with materialists, with women, unless of course their own wife. And neither will they associate with people who are attached to the opposite sex. Because this is very dangerous. Why do materialistic men associate with the opposite sex? Simply for sense gratification. This is in material. This is just the basis of sense gratification, the attraction for the opposite sex. Therefore, a devotee is very careful not to associate with the opposite sex or with people who are attached to the opposite sex. So this is how we can recognize a devotee. We have to try to look for these qualities in ourselves. We shouldn't be so much looking at others, but a devotee is careful to look at his own self to see how much he is following, how much of a Vaishnava we are. We're recommended, don't be critical of other devotees because that becomes aparad. It can become an offense. and offenses against devotees make it very difficult for us to progress in Krishna consciousness. Offenses are called hati mata aparad, the mad elephant offense. When the elephant comes in the garden, will destroy everything, knock everything apart. So the mad elephant offense can destroy our devotional creeper. So that is why we tell devotees, don't look for faults in others, but see our own faults and see the good in others. Glorify the other devotees. That's a good thing to do. Praise devotees. But criticism of devotees, that's not. But that is the job of the spiritual teacher. The spiritual master, and one who is a representative of the spiritual master, he can find the fault. Because he has to make sure everything is done nicely for the service of Krishna. Just like Prabhupada would tell us, Prabhupada would often complain about things. Why is this? Why is it like that? Why is your hair so long? You haven't shaved your head for 1 month. Go and shave your head immediately. You know, like this, Prabhupada, if you saw devotees becoming slack in their different things, he would get upset. And sometimes the prasadam is not cooked properly, Prabhupada would complain. Sometimes the flowers are all withered. Why like this? But he would also praise. Say, oh, deities are very nice. Oh, the altar is done very well. Look, the job of the spiritual master is to find the fault. And then also, of course, praise may be there, but not too much, because praise spoils it, person. Chanakya said, the father and the guru, and they shouldn't praise, they should find the fault in the child. And that way you get more. Child will work harder, do better. Just like we would distribute many, many books, and then Prabhupada would say, oh, very good, now double it. Oh my God, you know, we worked so hard, we'd drop in at the end of the year, Prabhupada, you distribute all these books. Prabhupada would say, oh, very good, now double it. Wow. But this is the mood, that whatever we've done, you know, it's not enough. Whatever service we've done for Krishna, we can never do enough. We can never repay the spiritual teachers and the mercy they've given. We can never do enough because we've wasted so much time in this material world. Now we have to use our time in the service of Krishna. And the best use of this time is to serve the Sankirtan movement, to preach Krishna consciousness, take up some service and do something to help this Krishna consciousness movement. And one who is not able to actually do service, they use the body, then you have to give some donation at least and help to support the Krishna consciousness movement. And if even you have no money, you can't give any, then at least you can appreciate that this Krishna consciousness movement is very nice. If you can't give your whole life for Krishna, then you give your body, you give some time. If you can't give any time, then you give some money. You don't have any money, then at least say something good about the Krishna consciousness movement. At least appreciate that this Krishna consciousness is very nice. The chanting of Hare Krishna is very nice. Everything is good. Like that, everyone can do something, some kind of service for the pleasure of the Supreme Lord. Then our life is successful. Okay, any question? Any comment? Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you for the wonderful class, Maharaj. You were mentioning about the demigod worship. Before I came into Krishna consciousness, of course, we know the hierarchy. Krishna is supreme, but in our family, we used to also have worship of Ganesh, Parvati. So when we have come into this moment, if we were to keep the deities of the demigods which are already been in worship in our altar as servants of Krishna or devotees of Krishna, is it okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's okay. You can do it in your home.
Yes.
Yeah. In your home you can do that. Yeah, we have quite a few devotees like that. That before they were traditionally they were worshipping many gods. But we should understand everything depends on the attitude of the worship.
Okay.
So what should be the attitude in worshipping Lord Ganesh and other different gods like that? The attitude should be that they are servants of the Supreme Lord.
Very well.
Right?
Okay.
And they're under his control. Where does Lord Ganesh get his power to destroy obstacles, right? It is stated in the Brahma Samhita.
Yes.
That because Lord Ganesh carries the lotus feet of Govinda on his two tamulai, the two tusks which are coming from his head. So from that he is empowered by the lotus feet of Govinda to destroy obstacles. Actually, we don't worship Ganesh to destroy obstacles. We can worship Lord Nrisingadev. Lord Nrisingadev is Vighna Vinash. He destroys the obstacles. So usually we tell people, you know, you want to, you know, maybe they thought traditionally we put Ganesh on the doorway or something that would destroy, then you better, you can just put Lord Nrisingadev. Lord Nrisingadev gives the power to Ganesh to destroy these obstacles. Haravasat Kanchana Kankanova. Varaparampata Kirita Justam Apyutamangam Namen Mukundam Savau Karo no Kurate Sapariam Harelasat Kanchana Kankanova. Translation. The upper portion of the body, though covered with a silk turban, is only a heavy burden if not bowed down before the personality of Godhead, who can award mukti, freedom. And the hands, though decorated with glittering bangles, are like those of a dead man, if not engaged in the service of the personality of Godhead. You can repeat. The upper portion of the body, though crowned with a silk turban, is only a heavy burden. If not bowed down, before the personality of Godhead, who can award mukti, and the hands, though with glittering bangles, are like those of a dead man, if not engaged in the service of the personality of Godhead Hari. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki! As stated here and before, there are three kinds of devotees of the Lord. The first class devotee does not at all see anyone who is not in the service of the Lord. And the second class devotee makes distinctions between devotees and non-devotees. The second class devotees are therefore meant for preaching work, and as referred to in the above verse, they accept disciples from the section of third-class devotees or non-devotees. Sometimes the first-class devotee also comes down to the category of the second-class devotee for preaching work. But the common man who is expected to become at least a third-class devotee is advised herein to visit the temple of the Lord and bow down before the deity, even though he may be a very rich man or even a king with a silk burden, with a silk turban or crown. The Lord is the Lord of everyone, including the great kings and emperors and men who are rich in the estimation of mundane people must therefore make it a point to visit the temple of Lord Sri Krishna and regularly bow down before the deity. The Lord in the temple, in the worshipable form, is never to be considered to be made of stone or wood. For the Lord, in his Archa incarnation as a deity in the temple, shows immense favor to the fallen souls by his auspicious presence. By the healing process, as mentioned herein before, this realization of the presence of the Lord in the temple is made possible. As such, the first process in the routine work of devotional service, hearing, is the essential point. Hearing by all classes of devotees from the authentic sources like Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam is essential. The common man who is puffed up with his material position and does not bow down before the deity of the Lord in the temple, or who defies temple worship without any knowledge of the science, must know that his so-called turban or crown will only succeed in further drowning him in the water of the ocean of material existence. A drowning man with a heavy weight on his head is sure to go down more swiftly than those who have no heavy weight. A foolish, puffed up man defies the science of God and says that God has no meaning for him. But when he is in the grip of God's law and is caught by some disease like cerebral thrombosis, that godless man sinks into the ocean of nations by the weight of his material acquisition. Advancement of material science without God consciousness is a heavy load on the head of human society, and so one must take heed of this great warning. The common man, if he has no time to worship the Lord, may at least engage his hands for a few seconds in washing or sweeping the Lord's temple. Maharaj Prataparudra, the greatly powerful king of Orissa, was always very busy with heavy state responsibilities. Yet he made it a point to sweep the temple of Lord Jagannath at Puri once a year during the festival of the Lord. The idea is that however important a man one may be, he must accept the supremacy of the Supreme Lord. This God consciousness will help a man even in his material prosperity. Maharaj Prataparudra's subordination before Lord Jagannath made him a powerful king, so much so that even the great Patan in his time could not enter into Orissa on account of the powerful Maharaj Prataparudra. And at last, Maharaj Prataparudra was graced by Lord Sri Chaitanya on the very grounds of his acceptance of subordination to the Lord of the universe. So even though a rich man's wife has glittering bangles made of gold on her hands, she must engage herself in rendering service to the Lord. Om Jnana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chaksur Milita Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Katamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Bandeham Shri Guru Shri Yata Pada Kamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamsya Shri Rupam Sakrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Harijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Harita Shri Vishakha Nitamsya He Krishna Karna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagat Pare Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namaste Tapta Kanchana Gopake Rade Vrinda Maheshwari Vrishabhanushtate Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare Hare
read a verse from this third chapter. Sukadeva Goswami is preaching to Maharaj Parikshit, and he's preaching very strongly because he knows Maharaj Parikshit does not have a lot of time to prepare for leaving the world. He has only 7 days. So Sukadeva Goswami is preaching very strongly to him, and he is describing about the condition of foolish, materialistic people. That they become proud of a little wealth, and they put a big crown on their head, and they think they've become king, or they've become very powerful, and they don't like to bow down before the deity of Krishna. Now, when Srila Prabhupada went to the Western countries, it was certainly a new thing for people to bow down. For Western people, young American people, to bow down, they'd never seen it before, never heard of it, and some people didn't like to do it. And some people would even argue, why should I bow down? Just like Prabhupada had one very senior disciple. He was a very big man. Even as a young man, he was huge, big size. As a student in America, he was a wrestler. You know wrestling, right? So he was a champion wrestler in the university. He's a big, very big, heavy book. So, you know, as he got older, you know, even in his early 30s, you know, Prabhupada was a guru, and when the guru comes, everyone would bow down and offer obeisances. And he was a big guy, very big, you know, not easy for him to bow down, you know, when you're big size. So one time he said to Prabhupada, he said, Prabhupada, says, sometimes I don't feel like bowing down. And Prabhupada said, do it anyway. Prabhupada didn't let him away. He didn't tell him, you don't have to bow down. No, he said, you have to do it. Yeah, it's even something maybe difficult for us. Prabhupada had one sister. She was also a devotee, Vaishnavi, named Pishama. very nice lady. She used to come. And when Prabhupada was around, she would come. So, she was also quite heavy, fat lady, you know. And Prabhupada, you know, she would say, "I don't eat anything. I don't eat anything." And Prabhupada would say, "Did you ever hear anybody? They're fat and they don't eat anything? Did you ever hear anybody like that? How is it possible?" She says she doesn't eat anything. Look at her. So, you know, like this, the problem is, you know, we get up, the body gets big. We don't like to bow down, but it's a very big part in devotional service. Prabhupada's godbrother, Puri Maharaj, he just passed away recently. He was 90 odd years old, very old person. He came one time, he came for darshan in the temple, Krishna Balaram temple in Vrindavan, and he came and he had four brahmacharis with him, some of his disciples. And he came, you know, he was very old, his body was very stiff, and you know, to bow down, his disciples had to pick him up and place him on the ground, you know, because he was all very old, the body was very stiff, but he wanted to bow down before the deity. So he had these disciples come, and the disciples would pick him up and place him on the ground flat so he could offer his obeisances. Then they would pick him up and carry him to the next altar, and then again place him on the ground so he could offer obeisances. And then pick him up and carry him over to Radhasham Sundar, the third altar, and then again offer obeisances. A very amazing example of how serious and how important it is to offer our respects before the deity. Just by bowing down before the deity, we make spiritual advancement. Isn't that wonderful? The devotional service is so easy. You know, jnanis, big scholars and philosophers and yogis, they go through great difficulty to make advancement. The jnani has to study so many books and try to get so much knowledge, and it takes so many lifetimes, and they advance very slowly with so much trouble. And the yogis, they may do so much tapasya, trying to progress, they go to the mountains, they starve themselves, they won't see any woman, nothing they will do, they will try to give up everything, all kind of sense gratification, and they make advancement very slowly, with great difficulty. But simply by bowing down before the deity, we can make advancement. It's so easy. Devotional service is so easy. The foolish people, they take the difficult process. Or sometimes people are just too proud. They're just so attached, they don't want to bow down. Just like one boy, a young American, was arguing to Prabhupada, "Why should I bow down?" Prabhupada said, "If you do not bow down before the deity of Lord Krishna, then you will have to bow down to old age, to disease, and to death. You will have to bow down to these things. Will you be happy bowing down to old age, disease, and death?" "No, nobody's happy when we get these things. We don't like to bow down to these things. But we bow down happily before Lord Krishna. With pleasure we bow down before Lord Krishna. And by bowing down before Krishna, then we don't have to bow down to old age, disease, and death. That is the benefit." Try to understand how powerful it is just to offer our obeisances to the deity. That we will never have to bow down again to old age, disease, and death. Upon giving up this body, tatvadiham punarjanma naiti mamiti sorjuna. Right? Because we have understood the position of Krishna. Janma karma chame devyam evam yo vedita. we have understood the birth and the activities of Krishna to be transcendental. Therefore, we bow down before Him. And by bowing before Him, we don't have to bow before old age, disease and death. So Prabhupada describes in the purport how there are different kinds of devotees. Not all devotees are on the same level. There's the Uttama Adhikari, the Madhyama Adhikari, and the Kanista Adhikari. And then there's the non-devotees. To come even to the stage of Kanista Adhikari is very good. It means you're a devotee. But if we're non-devotees, there's no hope. They have no devotion. They've not surrendered. So the other devotees, the Madhyam devotee, they have to go and preach to the non-devotees and bring them to Krishna consciousness. And they preach also to the Kanista devotees because they don't want the Kanistas to remain Kanista devotee. They want the Kanista devotee to also advance, to come up to the Madhyam platform. Alright, on the topmost level there is Uttama devotees. Uttama devotees, they don't preach. They see everybody's engaged in Krishna's service. But we want to at least, this Krishna consciousness movement, this is a movement for Madhyam devotees. The Madhyam devotees, they make distinction. We see the Supreme Lord and we offer our worship to the Lord. We associate with the devotees and we give mercy to the innocent. But we avoid those who are atheistic and blasphemers. We don't associate. Yesterday we spoke about giving up the association of non-devotees. Right? This is a characteristic of a devotee. Devotee wants to take the association of other devotees and give up the association of materialistic non-devotees. So this is Madhyama Adhikari. The Krishna consciousness movement is meant for producing Madhyam Adhikaris, preachers who will distribute the message of Krishna, giving mercy to the innocent, bringing them to a higher level of consciousness. So that consciousness, when the even if one becomes Kanista, one will offer respects, one will bow before the Lord. We may be Kanista, but we will recognize the Lord in the temple. At least in the temple we can recognize the Lord. We don't see God in everyone's heart. The Madhyam devotee, he can see God in everyone's heart. And the Uttama devotee, he sees the Lord in everyone's heart. But the Kanista, he's thinking God is only in the temple. But at least he comes to the temple and he will offer worship in the temple. That is good. That is the beginning. That is, he's a devotee. He has to progress. And he needs the association of devotees, of senior Vaishnavas. And then he can advance. So Sukadeva Goswami is giving two examples here in this verse. He mentioned, first of all, about the head, which is decorated with a turban, doesn't like to bow down. And then, the second example was the wrists are decorated with many jewels and bangles, and it looks very nice, very colorful, you know, sparkling, all the jewels on the bracelets. But what is the good if these hands are not used for the service of the Lord? Just simply making a nice decoration has no meaning if the hands are not used for the service of the Lord. Prabhupada spoke about United Nations. He said, so many countries have all joined United Nations and they put their flag outside United Nations. The flags look very nice, so colorful, all the different varieties, different designs of flags. But what is the result? Just simply arguing and fighting and quarreling with each other, just like barking dogs. Prabhupada said you bring a bunch of dogs and put them in the room together, they will simply fight with each other, just bark. So the United Nations like that has not done anything to improve the world. It has not brought any peace. It has not solved any problem. They made a colorful display of flags. But that, what is the value of that? And similarly, we decorate the body. But if the hands are not used in the service of the Supreme Lord, then it's just like a dead body, useless. So we have to understand that the value of everything is understood in how we use it in relation to the Lord, for the service of the Lord. The hands are given to us by the Lord. The senses are meant for the service of the Lord. Rishikena, Rishikesha, Rishikena, Sevanam, Bhaktir Uchate. Lord Krishna is known as Rishikesh, the proprietor of the senses. These senses do not belong to us. We are just simply renting, just like maybe this house. We don't own this house. We're renting. We have to pay someone. Similarly, all of you probably, the homes you're living in, you're renting, you don't own your house, you're paying rent, you pay someone. So this body also, we don't own. It's given to us by the grace of the Lord. We have to pay rent. We have to pay rent to the Supreme Lord. How do we pay our rent? By seva, by giving some service for the Lord. Using our hands in His service. What can we do? What should we do with our hands? Simply clapping the hands in the kirtan. That is using the hands in the service of the Lord. We use our hands to clean the temple. We use our hands to cut the vegetables, to prepare the food for the Lord. We use our hands to offer the aarti for the Lord. We use the hands to play the madanga and the instruments for the pleasure of the Lord. Like this, we using our senses in the service of Krishna. Of course, our example, our great example of a person who used his senses in the service of Krishna is who? Ambarish Maharaj, right? The king of Mathura. Great king of Mathura, Ambarish. He was famous. He defeated Durvasa Muni, but Durvasa Muni was envious of the popularity of Ambarish Maharaj. And he tried to give trouble to Ambarish Maharaj, but it was Durvasa who got trouble. So it said about Ambarish, Savaimana Krishna Pararavindayoy, Vachamsi Vaikuntha Gunarnavar Nari, Haro Karor Mandira Marjana Dishu, Shrutim. Shrutim Chakarachuta Saptakodaye. Like that. But Maharaj Ambarish was using all of his senses in the service of the Lord. But the first thing he did was to fix his mind on the lotus feet of the Lord. Bringing the mind on the lotus feet of the Lord. That is really the beginning of, that's where our real service begins. First of all, we have to put the mind on the lotus feet of Krishna. Just like South Indian people, they all know this verse stated by Maharaj Kulashekar. Krishna, how does it go? The famous verse by Maharaj Kulashekar. Krishna Tvadiya Pada Pankaja Panjarantam Adyaivam Vishnu Tamsavam Raja Prayana Kapaye Kantavaro Dhanavado Smaranam Kutaste. Yes, right, this is a famous verse in South India. Everybody knows this verse. Krishna Tvadiya Pada Pankaja Panjarantam. That Maharaj Kulashekar is praying to Krishna that let me die now while I can still chant the holy names of the Lord. But if I wait till I die, naturally, my throat will be choked up with mucus and I won't be able to chant. Because, you know, at the time of death, natural death comes, the throat is choked up, you cannot say anything, you won't be able to chant. So Maharaj Kulashekar, he's praying, let me die now while I can still chant the name with feeling. He said, what now while the swan of my mind is entangled in the lotus feet of Krishna. Krishna padara, Krishna twadiya pada pankata panjarantam adyaiva ve vishatu manasa raja hamsa, the swan of the mind. He gives the example of the swan. The swan plays with the lotus flower. You know, we all know how the lotus grows on the long stem, and the swan comes and he likes to play with that stem of the flower, and he will prod it with his neck. And what will happen? The stem of the lotus will get wrapped around the neck of the swan. Very nice example, Maharaj Kulashekar. He said, just like the neck of the swan is entangled in the stem of the lotus, the swan of my mind will be entangled on the lotus feet of Krishna. Let the swan of my mind become entangled on the lotus feet of Krishna, and let me die now while I am chanting the holy name in this condition. Don't let me wait till I get old, when my throat is all choked up and I cannot chant. So such a nice prayer Maharaj Kulashekar is giving us. We should be thinking like that. You see, chanting the holy name with our mind wrapped on the lotus feet of Krishna. So like that, using the mind in the service of Krishna, and then Maharaj Ambarish, he wasn't just only using the mind to think of Krishna, but he was doing a lot of service as well. His ears were for hearing the scriptures, his eyes for seeing, his legs for walking to the holy places and walking to the temples, and his body for cleaning the temple. Everything was used for the service of Krishna. So this is devotional service. We also want to cultivate this use of our senses in the service of Krishna. Any one of the senses on which the mind wanders can carry away the mind of a man, even of a man of intelligence. Any one of the senses can carry us away. Just like we see sometimes yogis meditating. There was one great yogi meditating, and he was in the Himalayas, and the beautiful woman came. Vishwamitra was meditating, right? Vishwamitra was meditating, and this woman came from heavenly planets to allure him. And he heard the sound of the bangles, and immediately the meditation broke. He just heard the sound of a woman's bangles, and immediately he broke his meditation and he became involved with this young woman, and his meditation was lost. All his tapasya, he had to start again. This was Vishwamitra. And then you can read in Srimad Bhagavatam, Sobari Muni. Sobari Muni was meditating in the bottom of the Yamuna River, and he happened to see, he saw some fishes having conjugal relationship. And he saw fishes, he became disturbed, he became agitated, and he left the Yamuna. Like that, any one sense can carry away the mind of a man. But if we fix our mind on Krishna, fix our intelligence on Krishna, then we cannot be defeated. The example is there, Haridas Thakur. Haridas Thakur, the different The prostitute came to try to allure Haridas Thakur, and he would say, oh, just wait, Manaji. I have to finish my chanting. I will certainly satisfy you. Just wait till I finish my chanting. And she's sitting with the whole night waiting, and then the morning came and he said, oh, I'm sorry, come back tomorrow night. Certainly I will satisfy you tomorrow night. And then again she came. And again she was hearing Haridas, said, just wait, I will just finish my chanting. So she was hearing Haridas chant. And then after she began hearing him chant, then she said, I also want to chant. I also want to become devotee. So Haridas' daughter, go home, give away everything, and then come here and sit here and chant the holy name. And then Haridas, he went away, and he left that woman to chant the holy name. So she had come to seduce him, but she ended up becoming a devotee. So this example was given that to show the power of chanting the holy name. That when we chant the holy name with full concentration, then nothing can attract us, nothing can take us away from that shelter of the holy name. So devotional service is so powerful. If we do any of these simple activities, just bowing before the Lord or using our hands to clean the temple, then we will be saved. We will not be affected by the material energy. Because when we're serving Krishna, we say, service to Krishna, Krishna is like the light, and Maya is like darkness. The darkness cannot conquer light. If the sun is in the sky, the darkness cannot put out the sun. The darkness is there because the sun goes away, because the sun sets. But when the sun is in the sky, there's no question of darkness. So where there is Krishna, when we're actually engaged in service to Krishna, then Maya cannot enter. That is the characteristic of devotion to Krishna, that it will naturally bring with it both Jnana and Vairagya, knowledge and detachment. These two things must follow where there is actual devotion for the Supreme Lord. Right? There are different kinds of religious faiths. Now sometimes people ask, how can we understand the position of all of the different religions and different faiths in the world? So we give the example, just like there is different money, you know, we have rupees and we have dirhams. And you have dollars and pounds and all of these different things. How do we know what the value of the money is? Is one dirham the same as one rupee? No, huh? You wouldn't come here if you knew that. You wouldn't be here. No, but there's a difference. Why is there a difference? It's based on the gold reserve, right? Each country has got some gold in their bank. And according to how much gold they've got, that is, determines the value of their money. So sometimes, of course, they devalue and sometimes they increase the value. It depends a lot on how much gold they're keeping in the bank. So in the same way, there are different religious traditions, different faiths, and they each have their different value. How can we understand the value? It is based on the gold reserve. What is the gold reserve? The gold is Jnana and Vairagya. Knowledge and detachment. These two things. You have to examine how much Jnana and Vairagya there is in each of the paths. Then you can understand what is the actual value of the process. Just like we see in the Krishna consciousness process, we have four principles. Because the symbol of religion is the bull, and the bull stands on four legs: cleanliness, mercy, austerity, and truthfulness. Huh? Satvam, Socham, Daya, Tapa. Satyam, truth. Socham, cleanliness. Daya, mercy. Tapa, austerity. These things must be there in any religious, civilized, cultured society. Tapa is destroyed by pride. Sometimes people are so proud, they don't want them. Why should I bow down before anyone? I was with Srila Prabhupada one time in London. We went to one Hindu temple and they had big pictures, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. And Prabhupada said, Vaishnava not only bows down before Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, Vaishnava will offer his respects even to the ant, even to a tiny insect, because the Supreme Lord is in the heart of all living entities. So we bow down before all living entities because God is in the heart of all living entities. So this is Vaishnava. So we're talking about using the senses in the service of Krishna. We have to make proper use of this body. And by using the senses in the service of the Lord, then we purify the senses. We give the example, just like you put a metal bar into a fire. When you put the metal bar into the fire, it becomes just like fire. If you leave it there long enough, the metal rod will become red hot, then it will flame, just like the fire. So in Bhakti Yoga, it's like that. By using our senses in the service of the Supreme Lord, then we are connected to the Supreme Lord, and our senses are gradually purified through the process of Bhakti Yoga. Just like putting the plug into the power supply, then you're connected to the power station and you get the electricity. So in the same way, when we perform activities which are connected to the Supreme Lord, then we become spiritualized. We become energized with the spiritual potency of the Lord. Because we're connected through service. That service should be done with the proper mood. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it describes that devotional service can be in the mode of goodness, in the mode of passion, and in the mode of ignorance. But there is also pure devotional service. Devotional service in the mode of goodness is we're doing it just to get rid of our sinful past, to nullify our sinful activities. It's not pure devotional service, it's in the mode of goodness. If we do service for name and fame, that's the mode of passion. And if we do service in an angry mood, grudging, why I have to lead the kirtan? Why I have to cook every time? Like this, if we do service in an angry mood, that is devotional service in the mode of ignorance. Pure devotional service is done simply for the pleasure of Krishna. We should all act for his pleasure. Then our life is successful. By pleasing him. How do we know we're pleasing him? Please his devotees. If the devotees are pleased, then Krishna will be pleased. Right? Sometimes we want, how do I know if Krishna is pleased? You will know if Krishna's devotees are pleased, then it means Krishna is also pleased. Krishna likes to see his devotees happy. Okay, Hare Krishna, any question? Some comment, question? Everybody agree? No argument? No? Everybody is going to bow down. Even if we put a big crown on your head, you bow down before the deity. Yeah? Everyone will use their hands for the service, even though you've got nice, expensive bracelets on, and you've had your nails all polished and everything, but still you're going to use your hands in the service of Krishna, right?
Maharaj.
Yes.
Maharaj, in my house there is two cockroaches. Just as I, there is two cockroaches. Okay. Just I am going to prepare something for Lord. Then I am cleaning and I am doing that. Then that cockroach coming in that, offering that food something. Then just I put like this, it's going. Again it's coming and it's going. Then I leave like that. Then after 1 week, it's coming four cockroaches. Four cockroaches. Then I thought, what I have to do it? So then I leave like this. Then after 1 month, just I saw more than 850. So what to do? For that, what I have to do?
Move house. Find a new place.
Cockroaches.
Yes. Well, what Prabhupada did, Prabhupada took the cockroach, he threw it outside. He said, go outside and enjoy. Don't enjoy here. This house is for Krishna's service. So you can do like that. You pick them up and throw them out.
I throw it again, it's coming again. I don't know it's coming from here.
Well, if you keep everything very clean and you don't leave any food around, you know, Prabhupada said, we're responsible. Somehow we're not keeping a place clean, therefore they're coming. If you have some dirty place like that, then, you know, they'll come.
Yes.
We make the conditions to invite them. So you have to keep everything very, very clean. You have to keep everything fresh, put everything away, don't leave any water or any place, dirty place. Then they won't come. They like to find the dirty place. Put them in the garbage, they're happy. Yes, Prabhu.
If we perform devotional service in the mode of ignorance, what will be the result?
Well, the result of the mode of ignorance is suffering. Suffering from beginning to end. Well, you can see, what is the result of anything in the mode of ignorance? It simply brings suffering. Results of activities in the mode of passion will bring distress. It's going to bring distress. And activities in the mode of goodness, they bring some happiness and a sense of being better than others. So material activities, yeah. Even we're doing devotional service, if we do it in that mode of ignorance, in the angry mode, it's not going to do a lot of good for us. We have to be conscious of what is our mental attitude. If we perform our service for Krishna like that, in an angry way, it's not going to relieve us of the material condition of life. We have to come to higher consciousness. We have to realize that this is not the proper way. We're not doing ourselves any good. We could say, of course, devotional service in ignorance is better than material activities. Certainly better than performing other activities. But it's related to Krishna. But it does have an effect that others become disturbed by it. That we come into a temple which is a holy place, which is a place of pure goodness. The temple is a place of spiritual world, actually. It's Krishna's abode. And if we bring our material consciousness into the temple, it's not good. You know, we are affecting. So we should, not that we should not come, we should come to the temple, but we should leave our consciousness outside. Don't bring that material consciousness into the temple. We should appreciate that the temple is here to get me out of this out of this mode of ignorance. It's a chance for me to get free of this mode of ignorance and passion. So we want to come to that higher consciousness. At least we aspire to cultivate the mode of goodness. And from the mode of goodness, then it's much easier to come to pure devotional service. The Krishna consciousness movement is meant for bringing people to pure devotional service. We don't want to just engage people in devotional service in ignorance. We're teaching about pure devotional service. The nectar of devotion, Prabhupada's book, which is written based on Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, is all about pure devotional service. We're not interested in cultivating the mode of ignorance. We want to get free of the mode of ignorance. So we can do this by properly practicing the principles of Krishna consciousness. Based on hearing and chanting. If we sincerely call the holy names of Krishna
we cannot remain in the mode of ignorance. When there's a kirtan, nice kirtan going on, and if we absorb ourselves in chanting and dancing, we won't remain in the mode of ignorance. When the kirtan is there, everyone feels the transcendental spiritual energy. So we have to go into that ocean of devotion and leave behind these modes of nature. Get free of these modes, passion and ignorance. That's the material world. But Prabhupada is freeing us from passion and ignorance. He's giving us the highest thing, Krishna consciousness, pure devotional service. No, but we should understand that there is such a thing as service in the mode of ignorance. And we should be conscious, we don't want to do that. We don't want to cultivate that. Yes?
If somebody is not doing service and he's doing in a mode of ignorance or mode of passion, and that's affecting other devotees also, then how to tackle this?
Well, good instruction, good example from others, and good instructions from qualified people can help to change. Somebody's in the mode of ignorance. We have to get them out of that mode of ignorance. We have to get them free. How can we get them free of the mode of ignorance? Simply by having good kirtan, by having a lot of kirtan, and by having preaching classes, letting people hear. So if you see somebody's in the mode of ignorance, then you tell them, Prabhu, maybe you need to go and join the kirtan. You know, instead of being here in the kitchen, or instead of you being on the altar, maybe you need to go and join in the kirtan. You know, that will help to get you out of that mode of ignorance. Because we're not meant to remain in the mode of ignorance. We've come to the temple, we want to get free of that passion and ignorance. We have to come up to the transcendental level. And that is here in the temple, where there is chanting of the holy name, where there is the glorification of the Lord, that is not under the mode of ignorance. It has nothing to do with passion and ignorance. That is pure devotion. So, if we see that somebody, you know, you feel that you know, they're really suffering, they're very miserable, morose, they need to go and join the kirtan. They need to have more association with the holy name of Krishna, and they will become joyful. Mm-hmm. I remember as a new devotee, I would often become quite, you know, mode of ignorance, mind coming out of the mode of ignorance and becoming a devotee. I still had a bit of mode of ignorance, quite a bit in me when I joined. So I had some service in the temple. I was doing something for the temple, but the devotee in the temple would see that I was getting irritated or becoming angry or so. He would tell me, "You have to go on Sankirtan. Today don't do this work. You go out on Harinam Sankirtan." And after I would go out on Harinam Sankirtan for the afternoon, I come back, I would be happy again, I would be joyful. So, you know, just association with kirtan, good kirtans, joining the kirtan for a few hours will completely take us out of the mode of ignorance. You cannot remain in the mode of ignorance and sit and hear the holy name of Krishna for several hours. You're not going to remain in the mode of passion or ignorance. The holy name is so powerful. Cheto Darpanam Archanam. Baba Mahadavagne Nirvapanam. It's the power of the holy name. It cleanses the mirror of the mind, extinguishes the blazing fire of material life, repeated birth and death. So, Param Vijayate Sri Krishna Sankirtan. So, this is a medicine for the material disease. We're all diseased. Kali Yuga people, we have the disease. Quarrel, argument, confusion, lazy, misguided, unlucky, always disturbed. We have many faults. But
Kaler dosha ninde rajan astihi eko mahaguna. Kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sangha param brajit. The age of Kali is an ocean of faults. But there is one good thing. Right? What is that good thing? Simply by chanting the holy name, one can get all perfection. Otherwise, Kali Yuga, what is it in this Kali Yuga? All plastic technology, all nonsense, propaganda, all so many crazy things are going on in the name of technology and advancement and economic development. It is all just sense gratification. And sense gratification is all in relation to the body. So it's all ignorance. But if we chant the holy name, then we can experience the spiritual potency. Then life has some meaning. The value of our life is not just nice motor car, nice air conditioning, big house, money in the bank, none of these things. What good are these things to us at the time of death? So Parikshit Maharaj, he gave up everything. And Sukadeva Goswami is now preaching to him. He's telling him. He's explaining to him the futility, the uselessness of all of this wealth, all of this advancement. One devotee was telling me how he went to Bangladesh. And he was telling me, in the villages in Bangladesh, you can see all the Hindu women, all their husbands go to somewhere like Bahrain or Singapore or somewhere or Dubai to make money. And they're all working there in the factories, and the wives are there, and they've all got big gold bracelets, all the gold jewelry and everything, you know. And the husband, where's the husband? Husband's away working some factory somewhere, you know. And the wives have got all these big gold bracelets. What good are these things at the time of death? Can they take these bracelets with them? So we have to realize what the futility, hopelessness of these things. What is important, that a little advancement can save us from the greatest danger. Svopamapi asya dharmasya trayate mahatobaya. In this endeavor, there is no loss or diminution. A little advancement can save us from the greatest danger. The danger is now we have the human form of life. If we don't use it properly, next life we may become animal. If next life we become cockroach, it's not very good, is it? Huh? If next life you have to again become cockroach. So that is the danger. Though now we have this human life, we have to use it for Krishna consciousness. Then, no more birth and death. Then we can progress. Okay, any other point? Question?
How can we develop our taste in chanting?
By more chanting. We don't have taste because we have jaundice, right? The jaundice, what is our jaundice? Materialism. We have taste for material life. Cricket match is on, nobody's tired. The whole day we'll sit and watch cricket match. We know, yeah. All of these, there's so many things, you know. We don't get tired when it's material things, you know. Some football match or some movie or something, nobody's tired. I have to see this. Bhagavad Gita class, half an hour. Very hard to stay awake. They'll go to the shopping mall, they'll spend hundreds of dirhams. They come to the temple, they have to spend 2 dirhams. Wow, that's a lot, a big sacrifice. Right? But we go to the mall, we go to the jewelry shops, we'll spend so much money, we come to the temple. So this is the jandas, material life. We have to develop the taste for the holy name. The taste comes by practice. You know, in the beginning, it's bitter. You have to do it. And the more you do it, then gradually, gradually it becomes sweet. Gradually. You have to get the taste. But because of jaundice, because of our jaundice, our disease, we're not able to taste the sweetness of the holy name. Rupa Goswami says, no one knows how much nectar there are in these two syllables, Krishna. He said, when I chant the holy name, I wish that I had hundreds of mouths to chant. And when the holy name enters my ears, I wish I had thousands of ears to hear the holy name. And when the holy name dances in the courtyard of my heart, then it conquers the activities of the senses, and the senses have no more power. So this is the power of the holy name, when we actually chant. But we have to develop the qualification, we have to call the pure name. Srila Prabhupada said it took him 32 years to perfect his chanting. So he was telling us, it's not going to be easy. Process is simple. I never said it would be easy, Prabhupada said. Prabhupada said, 32 years to perfect it. We may chant for 32 lifetimes and still not perfect our chanting. But we have to chant. The process is chanting. There's no other way. We have to be convinced there is no other way but the holy name. So with that in mind, then we take the shelter of the holy name. Feelingly call that name. Jai Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopal Krishna Ki. Okay, any other point?
Like, milk ocean is within this material world, so which planet it is?
Which place?
Milk, Chirsaga, where Chirsaga is to reside.
Oh.
Within this material world.
Uh-huh.
Within this environment.
So?
So it is in which planet?
It's in which planet?
Yeah.
Svita Dweep. Well, in the fifth canto Srimad Bhagavatam, you can read descriptions of the universe, and it's described how there are different oceans within the universe. And there's an ocean of milk also. Lord Vishnu is residing there on the island in the middle of the ocean of milk. Svetha Dweep. So, Svetha Dweep is, of course, Svetha Dweep is not annihilated, it's not a material planet, it's a spiritual planet. So, where is it in the universe?
It is material world.
Well, so, Svetha Dweep is not within the material world. Not because it's not annihilated. Just like at the time, 5,000 years ago, when the world was overburdened with many Kshatriya kings, at that time Mother Bhumi went to Lord Brahma to ask for help. So Lord Brahma then went to the shore of the milk ocean and he meditated to Lord Vishnu. And so the Lord from Svetha Dweep communicated to the heart of Brahma. So Brahma can go to the shore of the milk ocean. So the milk ocean is some that is there within the universe, but at the same time, it's not annihilated because it's spiritual. So this is an inconceivable potency. Svetha Dweep, that there is the spiritual realm. So beyond the material creation, there is a spiritual realm. And that is like
Sweta Dweep. Lord Vishnu is there. So they're within the universe, but at the same time not annihilated like other universes. Just like there's partial annihilation at the end of the day of Brahma. The planets, the lower planets are annihilated. And then at the end of the lifetime of Brahma, then there's the total annihilation. But Sweta Dweep is not annihilated. It's a spiritual energy. So, Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Abrahma Bhuvana Loka Punaravartino Arjuna. From the highest, from the planet of Brahma down to the lowest. But above the planet of Brahma are the planets of the great sages. It's not that the planet of Brahma is the highest. Above Brahma's planet, there are planets of the different great sages, and they're also eternal. They're also not annihilated. So there are many inconceivable aspects to be understood. The best way to understand them is simply through chanting of the holy name of Krishna. And then Krishna reveals to us in the heart. Krishna gives us the understanding, how we can understand all these things, by sincerely chanting the holy name. Okay. Any other question? Yes? How to do what? Which kirtan?
Satatam kirtan.
Satatam.
Endless chanting.
How we can do endless kirtan? Satatam kirtan. Well, Lord Chaitanya said, Kirtaniya Sadahari, always chant the holy name. How we can do it? Well, just by chanting. You can do it if we want. The more we have the Trinada Pisuniche Na, Tarora Pisaishna Na, Amanina Manadena, then we're qualified to do Kirtaniya Sadahari. So this is a qualification to do Satatam Kirtan. We have to have this mood. We have to be Trinada Pisanichena. We have to have these qualities. We have to offer all respect to others and not be anxious for respect for ourselves. Then we can chant the name constantly. But because we don't have that mood, that we don't chant constantly, the more we have developed these qualities, the more we will chant the holy name. There it comes. With qualification, there's qualification for everything. You want to chant the holy name constantly, you have to be qualified. We have to be humble, we have to be, think of ourselves lower than the straw in the street. When we have these qualities, then we will naturally chant the holy name.
Hey Prabhu, if somebody worshiping Lord Shiva, is considered as ignorant? What is ignorant?
No, not necessarily. One who worships Lord Shiva is not necessarily considered to be in the mode of ignorance. We also offer our respects to Lord Shiva. But we worship Lord Shiva as a Vaishnava. It is said, Vaishnavam Yata Shambhu, that Lord Shiva is the greatest Vaishnava. If you go to Mayapur, you will see in Mayapur, we have in Rajghat, at the Jagannath Mandir, there's one Lord Shiva shrine there as well. And we worship Lord Shiva there on Shivaratri. We have a big program there. Sometimes devotees observe Shivaratri. They're not obliged to observe it, but sometimes we do observe it. We can observe it. And we offer our obeisance. Certainly we offer our respect to Lord Shiva. Because Lord Shiva is such a great Vaishnava. Lord Shiva teaches us many things, actually. Well, Lord Shiva told us, Aradhanam Sarvesham Vishnor Aradhanam Param. Of all kinds of worship,
the worship of Vishnu is supreme. Tasmat tarataram devi tadiyanam samacharam. Lord Shiva went on to say, even greater than the worship of Lord Vishnu is the worship of those things in relation to Vishnu. Those things in relation to Vishnu are the devotees. Just like we do Prabhupada Guru Puja, and we worship Tulsi Devi, and we can also offer respects to Lord Shiva, because he is also in relation to Lord Krishna. He is a very dear devotee of Lord Krishna. So, if some people may worship Lord Shiva, they may be in the mode of ignorance. Like, they may be smoking ganja. They may think Lord Shiva takes ganja, so I can also take ganja. Like that, they imitate. Some people, you know, they behave more imitating rather than following the example of Lord Shiva. But Lord Shiva is always meditating on the Supreme Lord, and we should follow that example. Some people worship Lord Shiva to get blessings. They want some material boon from Lord Shiva. So that is the mode of ignorance, often, because the kind of blessing they want is materialistic. So, we have to see. But if a devotee, one who is a Vaishnava, can also worship Lord Shiva, to bless, asking Lord Shiva, please give me love for Krishna. Please help me to remember Krishna as you remember. So we can accept blessing. Lord Shiva has two potencies. One is the cheating potency, and one is the real mercy. Just like one demon, he wanted the benediction. Whoever's head I touch, their head will fall off. You know, he wanted that blessing from Lord Shiva. You know, that's a crazy man, you know, foolish benediction. But the real blessing we can get from Lord Shiva, you can read in Srimad Bhagavatam about how the Prachetas chanted the song of Lord Shiva and they got love of God. Krishna Prem. So that is a real blessing. Lord Shiva has his own sampradaya, Vaishnava disciplic succession from Lord Shiva, coming through Vishnu Swami, Balabha and Pushtimarg, that is connected there. And so it's a Vaishnava line, Vaishnava disciplic succession. That's good, it's not the mode of Kailash is between the material and the spiritual world. Kailash is between the material world and the spiritual world. It's not in the material world, it's not completely in the spiritual world. Between the two. Yes, Abhrama Bhuvana, that's the material world. Kailash is beyond that. Not there. Not between Abhrama Bhuvana Loka. The planet of Brahma's material world in this universe. Lord Shiva's abode is far beyond that. Lord Shiva is almost Vishnu. Right? Lord Shiva is a relationship with Vishnu. It's like milk and yogurt. Vishnu is the milk. Milk can become yogurt. Lord Shiva is a yogurt. Dahi. Yeah. Milk can be made into dahi. Dahi cannot become milk. So Vishnu can become Shiva. Shiva does not become Vishnu. So Kailash Dham is between the material world and the spiritual.
Well,
incarnation literally means one who comes down. Manifestation means form appeared. He appears, actually appears in front of us. He shows himself. Prakat. You can see him. Avatar means coming down, coming from where? Coming from Golok, coming from the spiritual world.
or coming from Svetadvip maybe. There are some avatars, many avatars, they come from Svetadvip. But Krishna avatar, Krishna himself, he comes from Goloka. The holy name also descends from Goloka. Golokara Primadam Harinam Sankirtan. Yeah, the holy name descends from the spiritual world. So avatar. Kali Kale Namarupe Krishna avatar. So the holy name descends. That's avatar.
What is the difference between swans and purnans?
Between what?
Swans and purnans. Means,
swans?
Yeah, Krishna, so many manifestation, swans, self.
Swamsam. Huh? Swamsam.
Yeah, swans. And
Bibhinamsa.
Yeah, Bibhinamsa is a jiva.
Uh-huh.
And swamsa and purnansa. Means.
Swamsa and
purnansa.
Purna.
Yeah.
Swamsa. Well, Swamsa means the Lord, but just means God, the spiritual potency. And Purnamsa. Purnam means complete. Purnamsa.
Balaram is
an
expansion of Krishna?
Balaram is the first expansion of Krishna. The only difference between Krishna and Balaram is their color. All the qualities are there in Balaram. So Balaram is also the eighth avatar of Vishnu. And Balaram has all of the opulences of Krishna, exactly the same. But he comes in the mood of being the servant of Krishna.
And
Vishnu is avatar. Vishnu is... We have the three Purusha avatars, for example, Mahavishnu, Garbhodakashayi Vishnu, Shurudakashayi Vishnu. They are Purusha avatars for the purpose of material creation. But Vishnu also has place in Vaikuntha. The Vaikuntha planet is Vishnu. Vishnu is not in Goloka. Vishnu is in Vaikuntha. The Lord in Vaikuntha, Vishnu, four-arm form.
That is
Vishnu avatar, Vishnu expansion. Yeah, expansion also. From Vishnu come different avatars, just like these Das avatars on the wall. They're avatars. They're coming down. Purusha avatars. We also say Purusha avatars. So yeah, Mahavishnu, they're also avatars. They come, they expand, they're coming from Krishna. For the purpose of material creation. So there's avatars in the material world, then expansions will be in the spiritual world. Okay, but we'll stop, Prabhu. Hare Krishna. Hare Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna. So today Maharaj has thrown us out of hints and the proofs for the pure divorce services. Hare Krishna. Vikram, hear all these things very nicely, but as soon as we are out of this atmosphere, we are completely in a different mode. That is supposed to be avoided. We should set aside to seek the ways for that purpose. And we ourselves are convinced that because of our material employment, we are changing. Well, is it so? I don't think so. Whatever the case may be, yesterday we were discussing with Maharaj, I was just mentioning to hear all these things from a very senior devotee. That is proved today. Hare Krishna. Now, I request Maharaj to distribute prasadam. Please come and accept. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Thank you.